Okay, we are live. So welcome to Tamarah's Closet today. I'm really excited. I have a very special artist with me today. He was born in Wiesbaden, Germany, but actually raised in the United States. He is a master pastelist with the Pastel Society of America and is listed in Who's Who in American Art, Who's Who in America, and in the Hall of Fame at the Art Institute of Colorado. His art is in public and private collections in the United States, Japan, Canada, and Europe. And he is also one of the world's leading urbanscape artists. So I'm really excited to have him here. I actually discovered him. It was on Facebook, and I can't really remember the exact situation, but I believe someone had shared some of his artwork. And I was really fascinated by the way that he used light in his paintings. I love light, and since I do photography, and I was really instantly drawn into his paintings through the use of light and, of course, the color. But what I really liked was the mood of his urbanscape scenes, because I felt like when I was viewing them that I was actually there standing in the scene as opposed to just observing it. And I really kind of would get lost in it. And there was actually a couple paintings that I love all of them, but there was a couple that really just captivated me as far as the mood goes. So I'm honored to have him here today. And so I want to go ahead and welcome him because I've got lots of questions. So welcome artist Desmond O'Hagan here with me from Denver, Colorado. Say hello, Desmond. So I know you're still with me.
Yes. Hi. How are you? Thank you so much for having me today. This is really going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm so excited to have you here because I really am captivated by your interpretation of light, and I know that's real important to you, so you're going to talk about that today. But I wanted to always have to start with the family background because a lot of people, you know, they don't have a history of artists or musicians or whatever in their background that maybe they can't do it. And sometimes it's not always the case. But do you have a family history of artists in your background? Or?
Not especially. More writers than artists. And my father and mother are good writers, not professional writers, but very good writers. And I never really took on the literal side. I was more visual, but they were very, very supportive in my work, even when I was very young. And I've been drawing and painting since I was very little. I think my sister has a little diary of some drawings I did when I was 4 and 5. And so I have improved since then, hopefully.
Wow, but I can't believe you started that young. So, but when, how old were you when you discovered you had a real passion? I mean, do you remember the first painting that you ever did or drawing? I mean, actual.
Well, it always was part of my life. I always was drawing. I was even in grade school. It came very naturally to me. It was something that, that was the way I expressed myself as opposed to writing. I would draw things, and I remember drawing and occasionally getting in trouble in school for kind of being out there just drawing and not paying attention. But I guess that's sort of the prerequisite of being an artist is to not pay attention and go do your own thing. But, you know, that's life. So it always came, like I said, it always came very naturally to me. And I love looking at paintings, and I'm always captivated by other people's style and technique.
Yeah, that's great. Well, I'm glad you said that because now I have an excuse for all that daydreaming I did in school.
That's part of the resume.
I know. But now, did you do finger painting when you were in school or anything like that?
No, it was mostly, I remember one of my first formal art classes. My father was in the American Air Force, and we were stationed in Fairbanks, Alaska, Eielson Air Force Base in Alaska. And my mom signed us up for some charcoal drawing lessons. And I remember first time I was playing with a kneaded eraser, the ones you use to kind of contour the drawings and erase mistakes. And at the time, I just it just really hit me, the darks and lights, and I really enjoyed it. I don't remember that much of the class other than the fact that it was just we were drawing fruits and, you know, little structures of some kind. And I really liked that, but it was very natural. So I went from there to in school. I didn't really take many art classes in high school. Actually at the time I was thinking more going into the sciences. And my father, when he retired from the Air Force, worked in Sandia National Labs down in Albuquerque, because that was the last place we were stationed, was Kirtland Air Force Base. And I really had an interest in the sciences, and I did well in school and with math and science. But the art was always kind of out there. And then when I went from there, I went to a college, and I decided I would probably maybe try architecture. And architecture wasn't really what I wanted to do. And I went from there to studying graphic design and fine art.
Wow. And I saw that you, I was going to ask you, I meant to put that on the questions, that I was going to ask you about the architecture, because I had another artist to interview that studied architecture, but he did not end up doing that. So.
And architecture plays a huge part in my work, as you can tell with the landscapes. Anything that has structure, even though I love doing landscapes, it's the structure of the different subjects that are really important to me. And that is from my love of architecture.
Oh, that's great. You know, I don't know. I have a brother that used to draw all the time, like you said you did when he was young. And I always hope that these interviews would inspire him to start drawing again. I don't know that they will, but he was actually a very good artist. But and he also was interested in architecture, but maybe one day. It's never too late.
It's never too late. Never too late.
Yeah. But your parents were supportive. Were they supportive when you decided to make it a career? I mean,
for me, it was difficult to imagine actually a career in fine art. Of course, the stereotypes of the starving artist, you know, is prevalent. People always think about artists starving. I never really liked that whole idea. I remember when I was 17, my father told me, he says, you know, what you need to do is put together a show, you know, and you can have it in the garage or somewhere. And at 17, I couldn't imagine actually doing that. I was like, how would that really work? So I think at the time, I wasn't in the mentality that would be a career. That's why going into architecture and then going into graphic design. So my path to becoming a fine artist was, I think, a little more unique. And the fact that I did come through somewhat of a business background, especially with graphic design. The one thing that when I switched schools and came up to Colorado, to Denver, to study at the Colorado Institute of Art, which is the Art Institute of Colorado now. And it was a really incredible experience, because I remember the first week I was there, I felt I was with very much like-minded people. They were all very creative. They were all very good artists. But we were trying to fit creativity into something that could earn a living. And graphic design was a fantastic direction to go, because it really, we explored so many different ways of expressing ourselves. And I felt that when I got out of school, graduated, and then joined an advertising agency in a design studio, what it did was it showed me there was a value in creativity. And that was really very instrumental in me making that jump to fine art a little later in my career, which was still in my 20s. I think I made the break in about 28.
Wow. 27,
28. And I always say, with the support of a fearless wife who, I mean, because I that's an awful lot to ask to tell your spouse that you're going to be a fine artist. I mean, that sounds like a scary proposition.
Sure. Oh, God. But now, is she a photographer? Because I noticed she was it. Didn't she?
Oh, actually, no. No, my wife is actually in the business community. Her degree was in business, and it's been very valuable for me, because she's a great person to bounce ideas off of, and It's been a terrific match in that respect. The photographer on my site is my daughter.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Both my son and my daughter are both very, very creative and very good photographers. Whether they take that into a professional direction, I don't know, but they really love that. And so she had taken some shots of me in the studio, and that's one of the ones that I put on my website.
Oh, I love that. I love that one, the black and white. That was really cool. I did. I posted that in the event page because I thought it was really pretty. So I like that.
Thank you.
But so you didn't do the garage thing your dad suggested. So it was actually till you were about 28. Now, how did you actually take that first step? Did you just call a gallery to see if they would exhibit your work?
Well, actually, the way it worked was I was working at this ad agency, great group of people, and I decided that what I was going to do is quit and freelance. And that was going to be a way of giving myself more time to pursue my art. And that worked well, and they worked with me. So I actually worked with them another year, but I was more on my time. So I wasn't going in 9 to 5 or 8 to 5. And that gave me a great deal more time to pursue my fine art at home. And I, you know, as I say in the workshops, when I teach workshops, I talk about the business side of art on the third day of these 3-day workshops. And I talk about you start local. You look at galleries that have similar work that you have, artists that are in the same point in their careers, beginners or, you know, mid-level artists. And then you kind of build from there. One of the most important things is that I put a mailing list together from day one. I wanted to make sure that people who were interested in my art, I had their address. Now, this is long before the internet, so it wasn't emails, but it was physical addresses. So I always recommend that artists, once they decide they're going to become painters, is that gather the names of the people that could be interested in their work, and whether it be at parties or acquaintances, friends, anyone that has an interest in your work, you want to make sure you have a way to get in touch with them. So, and then I went and worked with a couple galleries in Denver. And then from there, I worked, I was represented by galleries up in the mountains in Aspen and Vail, California, and several other places. So it sort of snowballed. One of the important parts of my career was I understood the importance of promotion, and that was partly because of working with an advertising agency. So I pursued magazines in the very beginning. I sent them information on my work. I sent slides back then, which is archaic now, but I sent sheets of slides to magazines, and that's how I started getting some of the first articles on my work. And of course, those were worth their weight in gold. People were reading them and seeing them. And so I have a never-ending appreciation of how that helped my career.
Wow, that's amazing, though, that you were able to do that. And now, do you think social media? I think social media has been a game changer in some ways, but it's also can be challenging. Do you use that a lot? As far as have you seen that's made any difference?
It has. Social media is all-encompassing. I still struggle for which direction to put my efforts into, but there's so much out there. I mean, communication has just leapfrogged in the last 10 years, and so I'm still trying to get my brain around how effective it is for me and which direction to take. Obviously, Facebook's great to work with. Many artist communities on Facebook, and you can post paintings. And the advantage is it's all free, much different than when you're paying for ads in, you know, magazines or, for that matter, people who send out brochures. I think that It is a game changer in the fact that people are it's much easier to contact people and much less expensive.
Right. Yeah. Everyone that I've asked that in any interview, though, they've all said the same thing like you did. It's very time consuming.
Yes.
And that's been most people's struggle. It's my struggle because I'm doing so many different things. And so sometimes you just have to get away from it because you're like, oh my God, I got to get away from.
Well, yes. I know. I mean, because my main focus is painting, and I don't want to be spending 2 or 3 hours on the computer. But it's nice to see those communities emerging. Artists, they're looking for like-minded people, and they want to show what their work is and have people see it. So I think it's a great venue for that. I do run some of the ideas on social media by my kids. My son is 16, my daughter's 20, and I'm always curious of what the next generation is looking for, looking at. So I've heard about, obviously I'm on Instagram and a couple other things, but you know, there's a lot of it coming and going, so it's hard to keep your finger on the pulse completely.
Yeah, it is. It really is. There's so many now, so it's a lot of them. But I notice a lot of artists are using Instagram now too, because
right. Mm-hmm.
Instagram's just mostly pictures anyway. So
right, exactly, just perfect visual.
Yeah, it really is. But now your parents are from Ireland, and I know you visited there. You visit there a lot, and I read in an article. I forgot how I got to the article. Maybe it was a link on your website, but you had, I'm going to quote you because you said the art of conversation is an important part of the culture there. And I was curious if that was the inspiration behind, there's two paintings and I was going to print them up and my printer is out of ink. So I was so mad. And it's the one, there was one where two men are, it seems like the table maybe could be round, and there's a bright light on the table, on the side of the table. And then there was another couple men that were sitting in chairs, looked like they could have been in maybe a hotel lobby. I couldn't really tell, but I just love those two paintings.
Oh, well, thank you. Well, I'll tell you the story on the one with the bright light. Actually, the light is that picture was taken from family members that own the painting. So that's just a camera that's reflecting off the glass.
Oh, but I like the light.
Yeah, that looks good. But the story behind the painting is the fellow on the right is an uncle of mine that passed away about 10 years ago. But he was a fantastic character. He was a musician, and ever since I was a young boy, and when we would go back and forth and on family trips, his band would be playing in the pubs and small venues in Dublin, and we'd all go see him. So as a young kid, I really embraced the atmosphere, and it was so energetic and intimate in a lot of mm-hmm. ways, where you had people talking, but when the band would start playing, and it was very much traditional Irish music. So I kind of grew up with that in my trips going over, and his name was Jim Daly. And he was just fantastic. He was a great personality and had just so many friends, and it was so great to see that. But the inspiration for me was being in those pubs and seeing how people communicated. And in Ireland, it's the art of conversation is incredible. I mean, they're terrific wit, really great feeling for conversation and stories. And so I experienced all that as a kid. And that plays into my paintings as well. So I like those intimate settings. Although I love doing the urbanscapes, I love the interiors. And those interiors were the ones that really excited me.
Yeah, I love the mood of both of those paintings. I don't know, I just kind of got lost in it. And, when I read that article, I thought, well, that must be inspired by the trips to Ireland, because that's what it sort of looked like.
Absolutely. And it is. I mean, if people have not gone to Ireland, it's a great place to go. There's so much to see, and that intimacy in the pubs and the friendliness of the people, you can't get that anywhere. I mean, for me, it was so, it hit me so deeply when I was a kid.
Yeah, well, that's great. One of the artists, I interviewed an Irish artist a while back, Tony O'Connor. He's an equine artist, so he does all horses, and he lives in Ireland, and he's very, very sociable on social media.
So, oh, is he? Okay.
Yeah. So, and he's posting pictures of Ireland all the time. So it's a place I would love to go for sure one day. So that's great. But I know while you 19th century Russian, American, I believe it says Spanish and French painters have been a real big influence for you. Is there a particular artist that you can name that has had the most influence and why?
Not a particular artist. I really appreciated groups of artists. One of the advantages I had years before kids and all that is my wife and I traveled a great deal. She was actually in the hotel business. And so any chance we had any extra money, we bought plane fare because we could stay free overseas through cooperation with different hotels. So I got to see all the great museums that at least were near the hotels we were staying in those different towns. And so I loved the Russian painters. And these, the turn of the century between the 1800s and the 1900s were painters that I really identified with. And these would be, whether it be the Americans like John Singer Sargent, Spanish painters like Joaquin Sorolla, Anders Zorn, a bunch of these painters, I could see their paintings and they're effortless in the way their strokes would go on, the way they applied paint. So I would just gravitate toward those painters. And I appreciate tons of different styles of paintings, but those ones in particular really jarred me. And so I can't really narrow it down to one painter. I think at this point, it seems like most of the painters that I really, really loved were of that period.
All right. Well, now when I zoomed in on one painting, and I wish it's not this one. It may have been this one. I'm not sure, but there was one on your website. Maybe it's that one that first pops up. But I could have sworn it almost looked like. Do you ever use a palette knife, or is it always
absolutely.
A brush?
Absolutely. Okay. No, okay. I use a combination. That was a great observation. I use a combination of brushes and palette knives. One of my focus or goals in a painting, even though they're representational paintings, you can tell what's going on, but they're made up of a lot of abstract shapes and qualities. So I'm trying to push texture, the shapes, the contrasts of darks and lights. So it's very much a somewhat of an abstract approach to coming up with a representational scene. And using brushes and a palette knife tends to give that abstract quality and a sense of texture. So and so that's kind of the way I went. I'm not really interested in painting photographically. I want to make sure that there's a sense of character in my strokes and a sense of emotion. And I achieve that by working with the texture and the different directions, working with the palette knife. And a lot of it is, you know, you come up with these sort of happy accidents where edges and you know, you scraping paint across certain areas and you think, oh, that just is really a unique effect.
Well, I like that, happy accidents.
Yes.
That's like, did you ever have a mentor, just someone to go to, and especially early on? Or
When I first started, there was a German artist here in Denver, and his name was Paul Cotney. He passed away quite a few years ago. And I didn't really study with him, but he was a terrific supporter of young artists. And when I was in my 20s, I met him through a friend, and he said, I want to see your work. Now, I was working full-time in advertising at the time, but I had been putting paintings aside. So I brought my paintings over to his home and his studio, and he looked through the paintings, and he says, I'll put a show on for you in my home. Wow. And, of course, I was completely blown away.
Ah.
And he says, but with the idea, he says, you have to fill the house. So I came up with 60 paintings, and I was working nights and weekends. And we finally had the show, and he invited all his collectors in, and he sold like 30 paintings. And it was great. Now, these weren't very expensive paintings. They were fairly inexpensive. And he had the, you know, the facility, the large studio to be able to do that. And he did that for a lot of young artists. And he was just terrific. And what was great about that is it gave me an idea that, this actually could be a career. So he was such a terrific person to know and to be around. But as for mentors, I really haven't studied with any other artists. I would say somewhat self-taught, although I was in fine art classes when I was in college and at the Color Institute of Art. But I loved looking at the books. I have seemingly hundreds of art books. So it was very much late at night looking through the books and looking at things that really jump out at me and how can I, you know, use that in my work. And I think a lot of artists do that. I think that they are constantly, when we're very visual people, so you're constantly looking at other paintings and painters and you're saying, oh, that's an interesting combination of color. How can I use that in my work? So even though I teach workshops, I also I try and tell people to paint as much as you can, as much as possible. Take the workshops, learn from some of the teachers that maybe get you to where you need to go a little faster. I think my direction may be in a little bit slower because that I'm just kind of moving along at my own pace. Whereas other artists can help you develop your style and your technique. But as for me, I really didn't have, you know, any mentors from that point.
Right. Well, what was it about the urbanscapes that inspired you so much, I guess, to want to paint them in the beginning?
A big part of it, I think, was the energy of night. And during the day when you have these cars and people, I love the downtown atmosphere, you know, people moving in different directions, the reflections of light if it's wet out. Night times, you have all these different sources of lights that are kind of hitting you. I just love that energy. I had friends that lived downtown here in Denver, and I was seemingly always downtown. We're in and out of the, you know, the different restaurants and bars, and they had gallery openings at the different galleries downtown. And there's just that charge of excitement, and I love capturing that on canvas or paper, and I just really enjoyed that scene. I love doing landscapes, but I tend to like the interiors, the urbanscapes, you know, more. I just, for some reason, those really, the electricity of it is very important, but and I still have friends who live downtown, so I always have a chance to go down and meet people down there and be able to see more. So, and it seems like there's always a picture and always a scene that I want to capture.
Wow. Now, are you taking photographs at all? Did you say, because you, mm-hmm. you said you do take a photograph. Okay.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It would be difficult to set up your easel and paint on the spot because everybody's moving and I can't figure a way to get traffic to stop for a couple hours. So everybody seems to be so busy, but so I'm busy.
I thought you might be painting just from your memory.
and I have done some small sketches like that too, but I like to be able to see what's going on. And I'm not really painting faithfully from a photograph. I'm moving fingers in and out because I never come up with a photograph that's perfect because I'm basically just shooting like this and trying to get, and which has been great about digital. So I don't have to worry about changing film and everything because that's how far back it was. I would be using film and then you would go and get it developed and then you weren't sure what you had. But digital has been fantastic for that because it's so easy to just go down, take a bunch of pictures, and then you can decide what you want to use from each of the pictures. And of course, photographic at night is tough because the light can be, you know, can throw your camera off a little bit. So much of the creativity is actually once you hit the canvas. The photograph is just kind of a beginning point. It's just a start. It gives you an idea of some structure, a little bit of color, a little bit of contrast, but it's really the imagination and the experiment happens once you start applying the paint.
Right, yeah. Well, I'm always fascinated at how artists get, I don't know how you start. I started doing my photography backdrops, but it's just abstract, you know. So it fascinates me when people can you know, just do that when artists can just paint. And I always think, well, I wouldn't know where to begin, you know. So, but this is a good place to show some of your work, Desmond, I think.
Sure. Okay. Well, I have a variety. The one next to me right here is a scene of Paris. My family and I were there last May, and they're very tolerant of me because I'm just taking photographs everywhere as we're going. But it was the first time for my son and daughter to actually visit Paris, and I loved all the light and reflections. So this is one of the more recent paintings I just did, and this is about 36 by 48 in oil, and then I have a couple of these smaller ones, and these are actually pastels. I work in oils and pastels about equally. Love both of them for different reasons. I love the color and luminosity that you can get from pastels. And it's a dry medium. Basically, it looks like this little cylinders that look like chalk, but actually they're not chalk. They're made up of pigments similar that's in a tube of oils, but they're just held together with a different binder. So when with the pastels, you're using big broad strokes, and that's how I would apply my oils as well. So this one's a little neighborhood scene of a little house not far from where my son goes to high school.
And, I love that.
But a lot of it, and this during the winter, and a lot of it is just working with very, really strong colors and then some muted colors. And the combination of two really tends to, if you're using muted colors, little gray down colors, it makes the brighter colors even seem brighter. Here's another one of another pastel, and it's a little scene in Paris. And show you
That's
up close.
Beautiful.
Thank you. And it was very wet when we were there. I love those scenes. But and we got a chance to go throughout Paris, a lot of places that I've been before. That was probably my seventh trip over there. So I'm constantly trying to gather different paintings. Here's an interior that I have. Okay. So this one, I lost my headphones there for a second.
But this
is of a coffee shop here in Denver. And as you can see, it's just a lot of light coming into windows and figures along the side of the wall, still working with brush and palette knife. And like I said, I just love those scenes. Very quiet.
That's very beautiful. I love all those. I love that one. I love the night Paris scene beside you. And the one very behind you, was that in Paris as well?
Or? No, that's in New York. That was from another trip. And that's walking down Fifth. And a good example of the that energy of the city. I mean, in New York's, oh my gosh, just what a great place, all the beautiful museums. And it was very cold there when we were there. We were in late March, I think. And but I just everywhere I was turning, you know. And one of the challenges of working with doing an urbanscape is that you are kind of bombarded by too much information. You have people, cars, buildings. So what's important for artists is to try and simplify and find the things that are really, really important in the painting, and that's what you're going to paint. Because if you paint everything, it can get very complicated and very distracting. Your eye, the viewer's eye, will go in other directions. So you really have to decide what's really important in the painting, and that's what you want to emphasize. And there are primary parts of the painting and secondary parts of the painting. And those secondary parts, you don't want to spend a lot of time. So you don't want to overly detail the whole painting, because your eye will just go all over the place, and it won't really take the scene in very well.
Right. Well, that the one behind the side you, the Paris one, that to me, that's very glamorous. Like, I would want that in a beautiful foyer or in a castle somewhere. I mean, it's just, I really.
Well, if you know anyone with a castle, let me let them know.
Well, maybe I'll build a castle. That's just gorgeous, I think.
Well, thank
I really
you.
Do.
Thank you.
I love all the light in it. But I imagine there are a lot of artists who have started a piece of work and it wasn't going as planned. And I've always wondered what you do. Have you ever done a painting that when you got through, you just totally were disappointed? And what do you do? I mean,
Well, not all of them work out. I mean, that's part of the process. Some of them are successful. Some of them, you know, maybe miss. It's very important as an artist that you keep your quality as high as possible. That may make you a bit less productive, but it's so important that the work that leaves your studio is the best work that you can do or produce. Because you don't want to be out there and be in a show or see a painting of yours and go, I should have done this with it, or I should have fixed it. So I try and keep my quality control pretty high. So yeah, there are paintings that just don't work. The one thing about that, you should never look at that as being a loss of time, or because you learn things when paintings don't turn out. You immediately realize that, I will learn from this. Don't do this in the next painting. Now, with that being said, I work on maybe three or four paintings at a time, and I'll put them away or put them against the wall at different stages. I generally bring them to about 80%, and then I put them aside. So I kind of live with them a little bit and then return to them, because sometimes something that may be keeping me back on one painting, I will learn to fix from working on another painting. So the process is very fluid. You're constantly kind of working with one, then going back and changing another one. And I have found that method has been very helpful, as opposed to just standing in front of one painting, work it till the very end, and want to get it finished. So, I mean, you should never be rushed in painting. So it's good to be able to put them aside and live with them, and see if they're working. And if they don't work, then put them aside and leave them alone and start something else. I mean, it is only canvas and paper.
Right. Well, that's a good way to do it. I mean, you might get inspired when you move away from one and work on another. You might.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, get inspired. But I was reading, this was several months ago, and I wish I went back to try to find what artist it was, because I'm not even sure if he's still alive, and I have searched and searched and I can't find him, but I believe he was an Irish artist, and I was reading an article and he was telling a story about a time where he was painting and he just hated it, and he just was about to destroy it, and then all of a sudden he stepped back, and then it actually ended up, he turned it into just this brilliant piece of work. And I was wondering if that has ever happened with you, or
yes, it has actually. I had a painting that I was working on. It was actually for a New York show, and it was a painting of brownstones, and it just wasn't working. I mean, the more I worked on it, I put it aside, and I got to the point at the end of the painting I just felt it didn't matter if it didn't work and it failed, but I was going to start experimenting. And I started experimenting on it and using, a different palette knives, and it started to emerge. And I thought I would have never been taken that risk if I was concerned about messing up the painting. In my opinion, the painting was already starting to fail, but I kind of brought it back from the brink by experimenting. And that's those experiences are life-changing when it comes to your career or to your technique. Because that's all of a sudden you're now leapfrogging into a different area. And I think that was great. You have to go through that. You can't stay even throughout your career with your technique. It has to go up. It has to hit some different plateaus. So, and that was one of the more significant ones for me, was the fact that I didn't care. I didn't care if the painting failed. And that gave me kind of free range to work away on it and see what happens. And it worked out really well. So I was very happy with that. And it kind of was another direction or a tangent in my technique that kind of exploring new areas. So I enjoyed that experience. I'm sure many artists have those. Those are those little leaps in your style and your technique that are just so valuable.
Oh, that's great. I've had that happen in photography where I've spent some time photographing my horse maybe or something, and I got into Photoshop and it didn't maybe look exactly like a light, but then when I got into the editing and the creativity sort of came alive then, and I ended up making something nice out of, you know, just in the editing, I guess, you know, mm-hmm. or the cropping. Yeah. But you like to work with pastels and oils, and I know, does you sort of answer this, but do they showcase the interpretation of light? Was this one better than the other, or?
Sorry, could you say that part again?
When you're working with pastels and oils, does one showcase the interpretation of light better than the other, or how do they differ for you?
Yeah, not really. I feel I can achieve that same effect with both pastels and oils. A lot of it when it comes to light is making sure your values, when your contrast, your darks and lights are pretty accurate. That way you don't have a painting that's just gray. You want to have nice contrast throughout the painting, and you can achieve that with both pastels and oils. As mentioned earlier, with the pastels, there's this purity of color that you're working with. The advantage then to working with oils is that you're trying to achieve that purity of color because you've been working with the pastels. The one advantage of working with oils first is the fact that you get that fluidity of color, and you get that. What's the best way to describe it? It's you get that beautiful strokes with that you get with a brush. You want to be able to get that sweeping, real great character to your strokes. And so it's nice, both of them work off each other really well. So you can get that, you can showcase that light really pretty accurately.
Right. Now, how do you choose which one you're going to use for a piece of work? Or is it just relative to the outcome? Or?
I think for me, it's basically just simple. The fact that I'd be working with a few different oil paintings, then I'll just want to switch to pastels. And so it just keeps me interested and engaged. And so it's not like one scene would only work in pastels and one scene would only work in oils. They cross those lines easily. I mean, anything could be expressed in either medium.
Okay. So. Yeah. Well, this is a question, because I being a photographer, I've read since your main focus in your workshops is interpreting light, could a photographer benefit from one of your workshops with the focus of the light? Because it just seems like to me a photographer could gain something from a painting workshop like that.
I don't know for sure, because most of my workshops are heavy on technique. And so it's working with brushes. And one of my goals in a workshop is, though, and this would lend more towards a photographer, is trying to see the scene a little differently and try to pick out those very interesting parts of maybe somewhat a mundane scene. So you really want to kind of get in there. And so I'm trying to have students in the workshops view things differently. And as opposed to working with detail, I want them to loosen up their techniques and really think in big shapes and the contrasts and the values and colors. So I don't know if a photographer would benefit much from that part from the technical side of my workshop, because it's really more applying the paint, and the photography is just more of a jumping off point in the beginning of starting a painting. But the goal of both photography and painting is the same, in the fact of coming up with a really unique, fascinating image.
Right. Yeah. Well, this is a question, I think, from a local artist here. She wanted to know what brand oils and pastels you use.
There's a variety of brand. I work with a variety of different types of companies and oils. Winsor & Newton's great. There's so many of them out there right now. But I've always liked Winsor & Newton. And the colors that I use are, let me look at them here. Ultramarine blue. Let's see. Cerulean blue. Viridian, which is a green, burnt sienna, alizarin crimson, cadmium red light, cadmium orange, cadmium yellow light, and titanium white. So I am only using 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, only 9 or 8 colors and white. And with those 8 colors, I'm able to mix and find whatever color I need. It's very important when you're working with oils, is that you don't have too many colors. That can get out of control very quickly. So narrow it down and keep it simple. And when I say keep it simple, that applies to pastels as well. Don't have a million pastels because that can just become overwhelming. So when it comes to the oils, I pretty much have the same feeling when I'm the simplification is so important. So my pastels is very much an oil painter's approach to painting, because I'm trying to keep it with a concentrated group of pastels, and then with the oils, I keep it to a small group of colors, and it's worked for me over these years, so I've been very happy with it.
Wow. But when you get an idea for a project, is it like your Paris series, or you had one New York, I think it was called, but is it just from when you're traveling that you come up with the ideas to do a series, or?
Yeah, most of the time it's coming up from travel. I seem to be addicted to travel, so I'm always out there looking for something to paint. So, and those sort of series really kind of pop out at me, especially wherever you're at. And it's hard to really describe. I mean, whatever kind of interests me at the moment.
Yeah. Well, I could tell you traveled a lot, so that's pretty obvious. And your work, it's just stunning. I really do enjoy it, because I have not been to Paris, so I enjoy looking at those a lot. So, but
great, thank you.
You do a lot of workshops, and I've read you had some really great testimonials on your website. So I wanted to know what was the most gratifying thing that you take away when you have some of these workshops?
I love during a workshop when you're showing somebody a new technique or a new way of applying paint, and the light bulb goes off, and they're making that little leap to a next level. And I love when that happens in a workshop. I've been very fortunate. The people that have taken my workshops are very, very enthusiastic, and they want to learn. And so that's been very, very helpful to me, is to be able to, and you feed off of that energy. And that's been really great. And it also gets me out of the studio and kind of meet new people. And I learn from the workshops as well, too. One thing about painting, it's a very solitary type of business. You're painting and maybe listening to the music and whatever. But when you're in a workshop, you're actually having to verbalize exactly what you're doing. And so it makes you rethink certain ways you paint. And it really kind of focuses you. When you're painting, you're thinking, okay, I need to do this. And then you explain why you're doing that during the workshop. So that's been really gratifying for me.
Right. Well, we always learn when we teach, you know.
Oh, absolutely. So, I agree.
Yeah. Completely. Yeah. And it looked like to me on your website that when you hold a workshop, do you sort of do both? Do you pastel and oils, or do you customize them more to...
Some workshops are primarily just pastel artists, but majority of my workshops are for both pastels and oils. So I always pretty much open it up to whoever it would be interested. And it's all different levels. It can be anywhere from, you know, beginner to professional. And I've had all different levels at my workshop. And so it's worked out really well. And both media, pastels and oils, work well with each other. So if somebody has been working in oils, try pastels. You'd be fascinated how that would help your, you know, the oils that you're painting. And vice versa.
Is that what you, because you are also read that you encourage students to try different things, to venture in, is it mostly just referring to try different mediums, or is it technique
as well, but also, I mean, look at as much art as possible when you're out there. I mean, look at as much good art. And you'll find that you'll start to slowly take things from some of this art that you see and incorporate it into your own work. And try different medias, expand your focus as much as possible. You will come to areas where it'll be your favorites, and that'll be things that you'll constantly come back to, but it's always great to experiment. This is one of the key things about being a painter, is you have to constantly keep experimenting. If you weren't experimenting and trying to achieve in the next level, I think you'd be very bored and it'd become very, repetitious. And that would just bore the heck out of me. I couldn't do the exact same thing over and over and over again. Not to say that I come back and work on several urbanscapes or different themes, but I try and make each one as unique as possible.
Right. Yeah. I have to do different things with guitar because I know what you're saying. I bore easily if I, you know, do the
Absolutely.
Same thing. Yeah. So anyway, but back in October, you were one of four artists from the United States be part of the second biennial Chinese pastel exhibition. And I wanted you to have a chance to share about that experience because there were also workshops there that you were part of. I think it was like 9 days. I just wanted you to share how that came about and what was the most valuable part of that experience that you took time with you?
It was a great experience. How that came about was, I would say, because I've my work is fairly well known in sort of the artistic circles, communities, and through pastels, and through the different associations I'm involved with. I was chosen along with, I think it was 60 foreign artists. There were 40 Chinese artists, so 100 artists in the show. And of the 60 foreign artists, 5 were invited to come to China and to do seminars, workshops, demonstrations. And it was a great group. There were 5 of us, actually, and a magazine editor. And it was a great experience. It was my first time to China. We flew into Shanghai and then traveled up to Suzhou, which is in the north east area, coastal area. It was through the Ming Gallery of Fine Art in Suzhou and the Chinese government. And they invited us, so we went to 2 primary schools and did demonstrations there, and 1 college. The students were all so enthusiastic, and they were just wanted to see everything we were doing, and I was just I was thrilled, and they treated us just like gold, and I hope to go back and, you know, maybe do some more workshops. And the show was a beautiful show. It was all pastels, and it was great to see such a variety of different painters and different paintings, and so I nothing but great things to say about it.
Oh, that sounds like an exciting trip. Was that I think I had read that you were just in awe about how excited the students were. Was that
they were. I mean, and the paintings we were doing were so different than what they were used to. So they really were excited to see how we created these paintings. And so we were really working with a lot of young kids, and I would do a demonstration and they would actually do work on the same actual picture. And so then we'd go around and help and kind of instruct them and show them how to do that. But they were very, very, very serious, very focused, very dedicated. And it was a very interesting time. And I've got to, you know, see parts of China that were just fascinating to me. Got to eat a lot of interesting things. The food was great. It was very enjoyable. But they really have an interest in the arts, and they very much they're very serious about it too.
Did you get new ideas for some paintings while you were there? Like, did you take any photographs? Or
yes, I did. I took many photographs, and okay. So those are probably a little ways down the line. I'll start working on those paintings.
Good.
Yeah, it'll be a little time. I'm going to be getting through this this Paris show, and then that may be some of the ones that I'll be painting down the road here.
Oh, good. That'll be exciting. Well, now I saw a video. I was just trying to understand what IAPS. IAPS was an umbrella that represents the societies, and the societies represent the artists. But what does this mean to an artist about being part of these societies? Or
well, it's an interesting thing that's evolved in the last so many years. Oh, this goes back maybe, you know, 25, 30 years. Is there are different, and I'm sure there are different art groups that go even farther back than that. But it goes back to artists finding like-minded artists and creating groups to have shows and to exchange ideas and to talk about, you know, what they've been doing. And with pastels, that has really grown over the years. And so there are different pastel societies throughout the United States, throughout Europe, Southeast Asia, Australia. And then they have an umbrella organization called the International Association of Pastel Societies, which is IAPS. And they have a convention every 2 years in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And that's where many of the members from all the different societies come to Albuquerque and watch demos, take workshops, see presentations. They have a big show, an international show. So it's important for artists to join societies and groups, whether it's Plein Air Painters of America or whatever group you're with, to be able to go out there and exhibit your work and show. I mean, it even though the actual process of painting can be very solitary, there's many places you can go to join, be with people that share your interest in art. And the pastel societies have been great, and like I said, that's global. They've got societies in many different foreign countries now, and the convention in Albuquerque has just been terrific.
Oh, that's great. I wanted to know too, if you prefer, when you're doing these exhibits, do you prefer, because I know you do a lot of one-man shows, or do you prefer one-man shows, or do you like being in the groups?
Well, I do both. I love good group shows. I've been represented by several galleries over the years. The one man shows are great because it's a nice series of all your work with a certain theme to it, and those are nice because I love working on that type of a show. But the group shows have been very good too. Well, the one advantage of group shows is you have buyers of other people's art coming in to see your work as well, and so it's a really a good business side of it too, is to showing as many group shows as you can. I've been very fortunate. The galleries have been very good to me, and I've worked well with them. Very professional, that's one of the important things for a young artist, is find a good gallery. I know the gallery system is thinned out a little bit in the last few years, and that's just the nature of how people buy. People tend to buy, they're buying a lot more, and not necessarily art, but things online. So I'm not sure how this is shifting, where this will be going, but it's just the way the nature of how people acquire things is changing. But I still think there are going to be plenty of galleries out there for foreseeable future. And so find a good gallery that you can work with.
Right. Yeah. Do you have is there a favorite show that you was especially meaningful? Or?
Oh, absolutely. There was a big show in Denver. It went from 1980 to 2000, and it was called Artists of America. And it basically was a regional show, national show, but it had a lot of, just the best of the best of representational painters in the United States. And it was held here in Denver, Colorado. And when I first started in the 80s, that show was had, well, it was going on for about 6 years because I started about 86, 87. And that was a show that all young artists wanted to be in because that was you, that was the visibility. People could see your work at this show. You had, you know, you had achieved something. And so I had applied to that show for, you know, as I, my work had grown. And I got in the last 3 years of the show, and then they closed in 2000. But it was a great leap forward because all the galleries saw your work there. And the fact that you were in the show gave you, you know, quite a bit of credibility. And so there are other shows like that out there that you can find. But that one was a big one for me. And what was interesting is that with my pursuing the magazine articles at the time, was very helpful. That all kind of helped snowball things. So if they, some of the people saw my work in the magazines and say, oh, he should be in the show. So it all kind of plays together because as much as you paint, in which I do, I paint a great deal. I mean, a great deal of it also has to be devoted to promoting your work and doing your marketing and all that, which is the nuts and bolts of this business, but it's important. I mean, people need to be able to see what you're doing. Otherwise, you're kind of painting in a vacuum. So, and you don't want to do that. You want to be able to promote your work.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, how do you keep yourself motivated and inspired?
You know, constantly being curious, constantly being challenged. I think that's so important. Seeing new art and say, ah, I could use that. I can use that, that combination of colors that they've done. It's a fascinating type of career. I mean, it's very up and down. Obviously, the economy plays a big part of it, well, you know, when it comes to selling paintings. But every day can be, you know, something new. Anytime you feel like there's some monotony playing into it, get up and do something else. Go out and, you know, see a show or go to a museum and find that inspiration. But it's a very self-driven type of career. I obviously don't have a boss. So, I mean, you have to be very motivated to do this. And so far, I've felt pretty good about that. And it's also a career that you can do, you know, forever. I don't ever expect see myself ever retiring because I love what I do. It's not a chore. It can be very frustrating at times. And it's very, very, very hard work. But it's very, I find it very enjoyable. And I revel in that challenge.
Right. And I would think traveling would be good for motivation too, just seeing different parts of the world, as much as you travel anyway, for sure.
Right. Oh, absolutely. It's very inspiring. I mean, you get out there and I mean, everywhere you go, there's gotta be some galleries and museums nearby. And so that's, once again, it seems like it's a career of constantly recharging yourself, and you do that with variety. And so that's really worked out well for me.
All right. Do you have a most proud moment or most proud painting so far that?
I think what for me is that I've had a series of accomplishments that have been quite motivating. I remember one of them way back, this would have been in 1997, I had sent some images into United Airlines Hemisphere magazine. And they really liked my work, but they felt, you know, it's an international publication, but they didn't want to make it too, you know, just American heavy. They featured a lot of foreign artists and everything like that. So it took about almost 2 years, and then they published it. And so they did like an 8-page spread in the magazine, and it was in every one of the airplanes. And I got tremendous feedback from that. And this was before the internet. So, I mean, people were calling my studio. And it was great because the actual 8-page spread was on a series of paintings of Jamaica, believe it or not.
Wow.
And so it was really great and came out in January of 96, I think it was. And so that was a great, 96, 97. And that was a great plus for my career because that was kind of set an international forum for me. It gave me that kind of a platform, which was great. Certain shows, being an Artist of America, had different gallery shows that I've had, which were terrific. So I think this career is made up of a lot of, you want to have these certain achievements and that motivates you to keep going. And I always tell them in the workshops is to try and make the distance between great achievements as short as possible. it's when they stretch out too long that all of a sudden you're feeling like, I'm just not getting the momentum that I want. So you create that by, you know, having a show, you know, getting an article, all that stuff. And this is part of the promotional side where you have to just constantly keep, you know, promoting and get your work out there.
Oh, absolutely. Now, you said that was Hemisphere Magazine, because the internet kind of beeped out a little bit when you were...
Right, yeah, United Airlines Hemisphere Magazine. I don't think that magazine does artist profiles anymore. That probably, they stopped doing that years ago. But I was fortunate. I mean, I was there when they were doing it, and it was a terrific magazine. So, I mean, imagine those magazines went... it was really interesting. I had done a couple charcoal drawings of this friend of mine who worked downtown, and she was flying home to see family over the holidays, and she came back and showed me the magazine. So she took it with her when she left the plane, and she was like, I can't believe this. You know, I was just talking to you, and now look at this magazine. And so that was, you know, really gratifying for me. It was like that magazine was in a lot of people's hands. And so, but like I said, you know, Facebook is now, or social media is now coming to the point where, you know, people can get that kind of exposure a bit easier. So that's kind of deep.
Yeah, that is. Well, what advice would you give to other artists that might be watching this live or the replay that could help them better get started exhibiting their work, as well as just, you know, taking that first step and I think that's scary, that first step.
It is scary. And, you know, my best advice would be to realize exactly what you are getting into. I mean, this is completely self-driven. And it is a great deal of hard work. And you really, really have to love what you're doing. Anyone who ever tells me, oh, this, you know, it'd be easy to do this or easy to do that, they've totally lost track of what, you know, how this works. So you have to, aside from being driven, is trust your instincts as well. You're going to have a lot of different opinions coming at you throughout your career. And you have to really trust that you're the best judge of your work. Keep your standards very high. Work very hard on your craft. And don't be lazy, because, I mean, there are plenty of people that are just as driven out there. So you want to be able to be, you know, front and center. And you have to realize this is a long-term career. This field is littered with many people that were one-shot wonders and then faded into the background. You want to make sure you're methodically, you know, charting your career through the years and gaining momentum. Try and create fortunate circumstances for yourself, you know, through your promotion and your marketing. But the primary thing is paint well, and is paint as much as possible. And wherever you can find information and help with that, take that up, because information is gold. You want to know all that you need to know. And it's always nice to have people that, you know, support and are as enthusiastic as you are about your work.
All right. Well, I think that's great advice. I do. I mean, I think it is. I think it would be a fascinating career, just because, like you said, you can do it forever. You know.
Right.
I mean, you
exactly.
know. Yeah. So, but and I love the creative world, the arts. So, you know, it's hard to get really bored with it, I think.
No, I know. Yeah.
So, yeah. But I want to thank you again for being here today, Desmond. This has been so great. You just accomplished so much, and I think your work is brilliant. And I think it's also wonderful that you're just so passionate and willing to share your knowledge through your workshops and even just in this interview. Is there anything that you want to add that we didn't go over, like upcoming workshop or exhibit or... Any news?
Sure. Oh, well, first of all, I just want to say thank you for having me. This has been a great deal of fun. It's always nice to be able to, you know, talk about what you're passionate about. So I really, really appreciate that. And I really feel honored to be chosen to be on the interview. As for upcoming events, I am going to be having a show on Paris. It's going to be in the first Friday of August, and it's going to be at the Sugarman Peterson Gallery down in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And that should be a really enjoyable show. I'm got a lot of interesting paintings for that. In 2016 in December, F&W Media released four of my instructional videos, two in oils and two in pastels. And that was the first time I've ever done anything like that. So apparently they're doing well. And there are different scenes that are being painted in each of the four instructional videos. So I'm really curious how that's going to go. But so far the feedback has been great.
It
was an interesting experience. I've never actually had cameras on me while I was painting, so that's always something to get used to. I think they came off really well. And my goals, I'm planning some more trips. I do have a handful of workshops coming up for this year, and you can see those listed on my website. And I'm sort of getting those all arranged at this point. But other than that, just continuing to paint and share my work.
Yeah. Now, will these videos, people be able to purchase them or?
Absolutely. You can purchase the videos and you can also stream them as well.
Okay.
So yeah, we've gone very high tech.
Okay. Well, don't hang up yet, Desmond.
Sure.
I'm going to say bye to the viewers, but you can learn more about Desmond at desmondohagan.com. And I believe I have his website underneath the YouTube video, and it'll be in my website as well. And you can follow him on Instagram and Facebook. Where else are you, Desmond? I don't know.
Let's see. Those are the places. Just my website, Facebook, and Instagram.
Okay. And there will also be a replay of this on my YouTube channel, Tamarah's Closet, and eventually it'll be in my blog as well. So I want to thank the viewers for their continued support, and please, please share this interview so that I can continue to celebrate Desmond. And join me next week, because I have another wonderful artist from Virginia joining me, Karen Hollinsworth. So make sure you come back next Friday to meet her. And to your own success out there, just keep on rocking it. And we'll see you next week. Take care.